Amelie? Amelie? Because every little thing. Because every little thing. Liz, where's Liz gone? Liz, I want to thank you truly for that most powerful and touching introduction. And you know, as you spoke, I began to reflect on my journey today and how the good people of St. Michael Northeast, many of whom I've seen as I walked through this crowd today, how they have kept faith with me since 1989. I don't measure my relationship on the day on which I was elected with them. I measure my relationship from the day I was nominated and became a part of that community. And I was 23 years old when I had the temerity to offer myself to this community as a candidate on behalf of this great party. But today, my friends, as we meet, several countries and several economies around the region and the world are today reeling from the consequences of natural disasters. Dominica, Barbuda, St. Martin, both the French and the Dutch side, Puerto Rico, Tortola, Houston and Florida and Mexico even, all have had hurricanes or earthquakes to blame for the state of their country and their economy. And the image of them having been set back by decades in their economic growth and development is before our eyes. But my question to Barbadians from the outset of this address this evening is, what reason does Barbados have for finding itself in a similar conundrum? Having just two decades ago been rated as the second best place in the world to live, and as a country that has punched its way above its weight, stated by no lesser person than Kofi Annan. Former Prime Minister Sir Lloyd Erskine Sandiford asked the pertinent question, and I ask it again here this evening, how did we get back here? His here meant where we were in the early 1990s, when an 8% pay cut in public salaries, public workers' salaries, Sir Henry, became necessary. But this evening, I say to you that our realistic here today is closer to the 1950s. Think about it. Think about it. I am told that the BLP and the DLP campaign, Sir Henry, in the lead up to the 1961 general elections, for exactly what we are campaigning for in the lead up to the 2018 general election. Today, our people are crying out for an ease in taxes, for access to pipe-borne water. Yes, access to pipe-borne water in the year of our Lord 2017. You doubt me? Ask George Payne and the people of St. Andrew, St. Joseph, parts of St. Peter, St. Lucy, St. John, St. Thomas, St. James, and in recent times, even St. Michael and St. George. Christchurch now too. Thanks to this present government, ladies and gentlemen, the privilege of free education has been ruthlessly snatched from a heartless government, by a heartless government. Our people tonight in 2017 are crying out for affordable health care, better jobs, wages and conditions of work, fairness and justice in the allocation of state resources, a well-functioning justice system, a safe and a secure living environment, an all-out war on potholes and poor road services, greater protection and support for farmers, a meaningful national housing program, anxiety about pensions. Greater protection, my dear, for single mothers, for the elderly, for at-risk young people, and other special and or disadvantaged groups in our society. This was the national wish list of the late 1950s. And sadly today, after 10 years of Frundell Stewart, it is the national wish list of Barbadians in the year 2018. It is like Michael J. Fox. We are now back to the future. But that's not the shocker, my friends. And stay with me, please. Errol Barrow, in 1961, won an election. And 10 years later, he asked to be judged on the performance of his government. And he defended his stewardship. Tom Adams won an election in 1976. And the Barbados Labour Party government that he led asked 10 years later under the leadership of Sir Harold St. John to be judged on the performance of the party. And they defended it. Errol Barrow won an election again in 1986, and 8 years later, Sir Lloyd Sandiford, his successor, under unparalleled circumstances, he may argue, asked to be judged on his performance and his stewardship. Owen Arthur, in 1994, with many of us, won an election and asked the people of Barbados 9 years after, in 2003, to judge us on our stewardship. David Thompson won an election in 2008. And 10 years later, Frundell Stewart is asking this country to forget about performance, to forget about their stewardship, and to re-elect this government on the basis of the social origins of his opponent, and whether or not she should practice law in this country. This Democratic Labour Party administration does not wish to be judged on performance, and it does not wish for its stewardship to be assessed. Because bear with me, after 10 years in office, they are tonight declaring to the government, to the country, that the next elections will be fought firstly in the gutter, and secondly, will be centered on who should practice law and who should not. And you know why? Let's go down the road. Richard Seeley cannot defend his tenure in tourism. He single-handedly has presided over the largest decline in any decade in this country in the government's tourism revenue since the Barbados Labour Party created the Barbados Development Board in 1958. We left tourism earning $2.3 billion in 2007. And in spite of the fact that prices have gone up by almost 50%, Richard Seeley is presiding over a tourism sector earning $2 billion last year. Shame on him. They cannot make head nor tail of what Dennis Kelman is doing in housing. But as Liz told you, a man that does not know that 80 is more than 20 can't do anything for you. They, like all Barbadians, consider Esther Bayasekou a national joke. And that one, Michael Lashley. They do not wish for Michael Lashley's tenure to be placed under the microscope, either in housing or transport. Barbados has been getting a lot of rain. We've been getting flooded. And it makes it very difficult for anyone to understand what Dennis Lowe is doing that could cause him to believe that he is a success. For he remains Lowe by name and by performance always. They tell me that there's a pit bull, but we all know that the pit bull is all bark and no bite. And then there is one called Donville Innes. Up and down, up and down, up and down. He continues to prove the age-old adage, century-old, that empty vessels keep the loudest noise. And what do I say about Steve Blackett? Or should I say sleeve jacket? Well, Stephen Lashley right now is receiving a minister's salary to oversee the running of a single festival that the Barbados Labour Party perfected long time ago. With the worry that all Barbadians feel about crime, where can we find solace from the performance of Adria Braffitt? And a man who occupies my old school building across the road, Ronald Jones, he is too angry with the world for anyone to understand what are his policies and what are his plans. He spends his time berating everyone that he meets. Have I forgotten some people? I wonder who. John Boyce, thank you. Easily, Cynthia reminds me that he's John Voice. Easily and with distinction, the most uncaring Minister of Health that this country has ever seen. And don't worry about Maxine McLean, as a Henry and Dame Billy, as foreign ministers of old. You should both be concerned and salute that diplomats the world over are shaking their heads in bewilderment. And this is a serious matter over what has become of the standing of Barbados. And that the truth is that it is enough to make you cry. But I can't believe that you haven't called a name yet. Oh, who? Oh dear, how could I forget about Chris Sinclair? But you see, you can't forget about Chris Sinclair, because when you say the word Sinclair, what is the word that rings in your head the most? Sink. So what could we expect when we put a Minister of Finance in charge whose name was Sinclair? Sinclair must sink the country's finances. Let me tell you all this. You know, this microphone for me feels too constraining and this podium, that's the truth. But I want you to understand this, that instead of talking nonsense about elitism and Frondell Stewart promising to explain me to the country, I want you to carry a message to Bay Street or George Street for me. I ask Frondell Stewart to explain these few questions. One, why is he, as minister responsible for town planning, allowing a businessman to flout the rule of law and to disobey the orders of the chief town planner? Mark my words. Why is he? Why is he, as minister responsible for CBC, allowing the Caribbean Broadcasting Corporation to amass a debt of over $120 million. And he has studiously avoided giving the country an explanation whatsoever, given the buildup of that debt. You would believe that a corporation that is so desperate for money would want to take the $4,000 that General Secretary of the Barbados Labour Party wanted to pay to broadcast this conference tomorrow night. Not even live. They carried him live in George Street. We understand that we live in a dictatorship today. But we are prepared, my friends, to pay $4,000 to CBC. And General Secretary, please release all of the letters between the Barbados Labour Party and CBC for the public of Barbados to see for themselves. Yes. But now let's stop there. Why is the Prime Minister of Barbados not yet telling the country that he was the first minister to sign the Cahill Memorandum of Understanding 6 months before any other minister in his cabinet? I said in the budget reply that this is a man fish cakes, wipe his mouth clean, but forget and put the greasy napkin in the pocket. But as if that were not enough, Frundell Stewart must tell the country if he is not ashamed to have presided over this country's 20 downgrades in our credit rating, while rewarding the Minister of Finance for this extraordinary feat by leaving Chris Sinclair in position after each and every downgrade in this country. If a man deceives me once, shame on. And if he deceives me twice, shame on. Frundell Stewart, you are the one, not Chris Sinclair, who must take responsibility for this extraordinary demise of Barbados's credit rating. Let us be clear. Through the callous and uncaring disconnection from his leadership responsibility of any form or fashion, Frundell Stewart has been the engineer of the greatest betrayal to a generation in modern Barbados of Barbadians who have hitherto never fathomed the thought of a rudderless Barbados, nor the resultant dire consequences which have now become our sad reality. And you remember them. In 2003, before we faced the election, they told us no layoffs, no sell-offs, no fees for university students. And just after the election, within months, a complete U-turn. Fees introduced at UWE, 3,000 persons to go home, and the selling of state enterprises and government property in spite of all kinds of assurances from them. You know what happened? All seriousness, you know what happened? From the time this government was elected, they never left the mode of opposition politics. That's a fact. They never left it. They never accepted that their role was to be responsible for the governance of this country. So, my friends, it should be no surprise this evening that that party has presided over the near collapse of almost everything that Barbadians have held dear for 50 years, and that they are unwilling to submit themselves to any form of national scrutiny. They started a fax campaign. Remember I told you, Frundell and Chris talking? Stupidness. And after 2 weeks, 3 weeks, with most of it focused on George Pilgrim's dear friend Ronald Jones, the campaign fizzled out. And even when the campaign told us what they had done, it ran into trouble. You know why? Because their own supporters were unimpressed. So today, when I tell you that you have an incumbent government telling you, judge us not on our performance, but on who went to school where by bus and who went to school by car, that is the madness to which Barbados has descended because of the utter incompetence of this government. I go around this country every single day. Yes, rubbing shoulders. And the cries of the people are crystal clear. Bajans want solutions to their problems. They want restoration of pride in what we call brand Barbados. They want Barbados to be respected again. They want Barbadian children to be afforded the prospect of a decent and dignified existence. But where do we find ourselves in 2017? And we heard Lisa Cummins in an extraordinary address last night, saddled with a leader who boasts to the world that he manages to move around the country incognito. You understand where the Prime Minister tells you that he is boasting that he can move around incognito, that nobody recognizes him, that he is accountable to no one, and that everybody knows that he is inaccessible. Study yourself. In 8 years, think about it, in eight years as leader of this country, Kirk, and you got to remind the people in South, Frandell Stewart has touched and spoken out to more repeat visitors at Ilara Court than he has touched and spoken to ordinary Bajans who put him in there. For real, he has commiserated with victims of tragedies the world over. But he has been indifferent to the plight of the residents on the South Coast, William Duguid and Ralph Thorne, who continue for days, every time there's heavy rainfall, to have feces seeping into their homes and the yards. And to the people, George, of White Hill, who have been forced to beg for the right to exist in this land, the land of their birth. Frandell Stewart does not come to them. He does not come to the people in the north who have no water. So, we are assembled here, my friends, at the 79th conference of the Barbados Labour Party. Not for any regular feel-good event, although it feels good. Thank you, Jesus. The red is pleasing. But what we are assembled here is because we live in a time when the country which we love dear is bleeding from the nose, where its vital signs are of concern, even to the most staunch of Democratic Labour Party supporters. I want to make it clear from the outset this evening that I'm not here to curse anybody. I have contested 6 general elections in this country. And not once have I had to get in the gutter. I do not go in the gutter to win St. Michael Northeast. And I will not go into the gutter to capture the hearts and the imagination of the people of Barbados. The Barbados Labour Party shall keep it clean in 2018. But those who get offended because I speak about stealing, I say too bad for them. This country is short of cash. And if you have taken more than was legitimately yours, do not take it personal when I reveal and we reveal the facts to the country. And these are the things that Bajans are asking. How does an average minister take home no more than $10,000 or $12,000 a month? If you multiply that by a total of 10 years, 120 months, my simple arithmetic at 10,000 gives me a total of $1.2 million for the entire period of 10 years that they would have served as a minister. If, therefore, we have reason to believe or evidence to support the argument that people have amassed assets in excess of that which reasonably could have become theirs from their lawful earnings, do not get angry with us when we call upon you to account. If you cannot afford to buy luxury vehicles, either brought in full or in parts. If you cannot afford to buy luxury vehicles in full or in parts, do not drive them around cutting style as if you bought them. Sonia, what you sang for this year, you sang what? A change is coming. You didn't tell the others that last year you sang Sim Simma. Who got the keys to my bimmer? The only problem is that the bimmer reduced down there to a Range Rover now. If prior to 2008, you could barely afford to pay the mortgage on your house, How is it that you have... I am not going low today at all, at all, at all. If you could not afford the mortgage on your house, how is it that you have either acquired an even more affluent residence without a known mortgage, or that the market value of your home has quadrupled in 10 years with no refinancing from any mortgage? My friends, listen to me and listen carefully. I will be asking and indeed answering similar questions in the weeks and the months ahead. And I do not want anybody in here referring to this as gutter politics. I do not know why this government has never proclaimed the integrity legislation, the Prevention of Corruption Act, that it passed and to which the Governor General assented in 2012. But I will be asking some questions when the time is right. And I have more to share to you about the difference of us and them on that topic this evening. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are assembled here this evening to provide Barbadians with an insight into how we shall govern and the difference we are going to make in your lives. And I want you now to listen to me carefully, because I have been in politics long enough to know that nothing I say will be enough to convince 35% of the population of this country. That's the nature of our politics. Nothing. It's a sad reality. But that is not the only reality. I also want the naysayers to embrace the fact that on every occasion in the past 79 years that this Barbados Labour Party has been tried, it has made a positive difference in the lives of the people of this country. In 1951, when for the first time we took control, because I don't count, although the manifesto of 1944 clearly had an impact on the governor in council. But from 1951, when Sir Grantley Adams confronted taking a Barbados that was so poignantly described in the Moyne Commission as one where people literally, literally were living on the edge of the most base and human conditions that any human being could live in, the Barbados Labour Party lifted people out of that between 1951 and 1961. From labour legislation to schools to hospitals to everything was laid in place, to the beginning of the Deepwater Harbour, to the Development Board, to which I just referred, dealing with tourism and industry. In 1976, Sir Henry, Dame Billy, Sir Richard, Sir Louis, you can speak to this better than me. You inherited a government that was confronted by a slot of crash programs and three-day weeks. Almost 400 small shops closed down. 14-year-old children put out of school. Do you recall that, some of you? And then again in 1994, we inherited a near calamitous situation, and we immediately went to work and reversed the social and economic trajectory of this country. I want voters in Barbados to do me one favor. Reflect on why you voted for the Labour Party in 1981 and why you voted for us in 1999. And you voted for us then because on both occasions, we performed. You voted to give us second terms because we kept our promises and because we delivered. And this Labour Party gets the job done. And repeatedly, it can be relied on to clean up the mess of the Democratic Labour Party. So don't come asking me how you know you can trust the BLP. Don't come asking me whether the BLP will make a difference. We made a difference in 1951. We made a difference in 1976. And we made a difference in 1994. And I am here tonight to tell you that we will make a difference because the best is yet to come. And why do I say so? In 2018, we will inherit the worst performing economy ever in the history of modern Barbados. But I am confident that after 4 years, we shall have earned the right to come back to the people of Barbados for a second term. So my simple message to you, the Doubting Thomases, this evening, judge us on our record. That's all. Judge us on our character and our record. Judge the Barbados Labour Party on the previous term. This party is not a fly-by-night institution. We celebrate 80 years come the 31st of March next year, the oldest political party in the English-speaking Caribbean. And we will come back to Queen's Park to commemorate that. And we shall either be on the eve of an election or we shall be in the shadow of a victory. We are fielding a slate of Y2K20 compliant candidates. And among them is a cadre of seasoned and experienced practitioners, and you heard them this evening, none of whom anybody can point a credible finger about corruption against. We have a perfect blend of youth and dynamism. And then, as I've said to you over and over, we have the reservoir of the Labour Party, all of whom are still here, who served in previous governments from Sir Henry and the others right back down. Under the best of Tom's cabinet and the best of Owen's cabinet, they are with us to mentor, guide, and assist our team in this national rebuilding effort for Product Barbados. So I ask you, please, do not question our capacity. We have rescued this country before, and with the help of the Almighty, we shall rescue this country again. So comrades, over my career, while enjoying the journey, I've always believed that you have to shoulder the awesome privilege of service with the seriousness of purpose that it deserves. And that is why 2 years ago, I brought to this annual conference at Foundation School a draft covenant of hope for this party to sign off on. And we were able to launch it in 2016. But I want you to remember what a covenant is, lest you forget. Because a covenant is a pact between independent groups, private sector, unions, poor people, rich people, black, white, Indians, all kinds of groups who want to work together to achieve what none of them can achieve on their own. That is what a covenant is. And that is why we have been deliberate in our choice of language, because we know that it will take everybody working together in this country to bring Barbados back to where we want it to go. And that is why when they say that we are anxious to gain office, it's not that we want power. It's not that we're impatient for power. But we recognize, and listen to this, we recognize that November 30th, next month, is going to be the first day of the next 50 years of this country's life as a nation. November 30th will be the first day of the next 50 years of this country's life as a nation. And what we do in the first 5 years, the first 10 years, will be what is necessary to secure the next 50 years of Barbados as a fair and just society. We have to transform Barbados now, not restore it. We can't restore it. We have to transform our nation so that the dreams and aspirations of individuals may be met. And therefore, forgive me if I stop now. litigating the case against the government. You know it well. I know it well. Bajans already agree this is the worst government ever in the history of this country. And even strong Dems sin and lament in the words of Bob Marley that there has been an ambush in the night by persons who have no philosophical grounding and who have shown that they do not care about Bajans in this new Democratic Labour Party. I ask you to focus your attention on nothing else when you leave here, on what is the difference between us and the Democratic Labour Party. And it is very simple, because there's going to be a lot of misinformation floating about. But here are the differences. One, we put people first. I want to repeat it. We put people first, always. Two, we are committed to a new governance framework and will address systemic corruption. Three, we are, and don't feel no way, we are the best at fixing this economy. It's not an idle boast. Four, we are prepared to innovate and to think outside the box. But most importantly of all, unlike this current government, simple thing. We know how to get things done. Simple. We know how to get things done. So one of the first things that sets us apart, I tell you, is putting people first. And I'm going to carry you through them very quickly. Because I'm conscious of the hour, but I also am conscious that we go to watch a T20 match for 4 hours. And I will speak to you for an hour or a little bit just to give you the foundation for this country's future. Not an hour more. You remember how we ring-fenced public servant salary after 1994? Can you imagine if that fiscal weapon was still available to Chris Sinclair and Frandell Stewart? They would have cut your salary and still not got you to safety today. But it was a Barbados Labour Party administration that said no, that there should not be a disproportionate burden borne by the people of Labour in this country. All the talk about being progressive since this government took office, it's only been empty rhetoric. We come down the line, come right down. And when you check on it, what is it that we are talking about in this country? That students of the University of the West Indies have been put on the block because this government simply has not been creative enough to make a difference in knowing how to afford what they have to afford to pay for fees in this country. We will not do that. And I want to tell you here tonight that a Barbados Labour Party government will do everything in its power, every single thing in its power, to restore the situation where Barbadian students will not pay fees at the University of the West Indies. I want to tell you as well that those who tell you that we cannot afford it, ask them the cost of not doing it. You heard Lisa come and stand on this platform last night and tell you that were it not for free education, she could not be here talking to you. And we know how many more in this room for whom that can be said. 80% of the students going to Cave Hill come from working class Barbadians. Homes, 80%. And I want to say to you that government is about choice. So when they ask you, tell them this. It is our choice to pay for Barbadian students at the University of the West Indies. We will find the money to do so. I want also to talk to you about the rest of our children. Because our children come from a position where we can't only look at the university education. We have to look at what else they're being exposed to. Because we have a very simple premise that to those who need the greatest assistance, we must provide them. This country and this party has always known what it is to take care of our people. And we are not going to expose the most vulnerable at their greatest hour of need. The welfare state is not a bad word in this country, and certainly not in this party. What does the New Testament teach us? What does the political philosophy of the Barbados Labour Party teach you? And what is now a human right in the world in terms of shelter and food and water? And to that we add tonight education for our children. Because without education they cannot rise from poverty. And I say to you tonight that the bedrock of development and the foundation of a Barbados Labour Party government will be education. For those who may not reach it to tertiary, they must leave school knowing by 2030 that every one of our children have been exposed to be able to speak two languages, not just English. That every one of our children should have been exposed to be able to swim. How do you not swim on an island? How do you not teach your children to swim on an island? It's a mindset that we fight into. They should be exposed to play another sport. And they should all be exposed to some form of the arts, be it an instrument, be it dance, or be it artistic. We have to give our children the best possible opportunity in this country to become adults. Each and every one of us would do it for our individual children. Why are we not prepared to do it for the children of the nation? Well, they say I don't have children, so let me declare now that my children are all the children of the nation. And I want to talk to you about the high rate of crime among some of our young people. You know, this suggests that more resources, not less resources, are needed in social work in this country and social programs in our schools to address the behavioral problems. John, you see it firsthand in the social work. People know John as a Calypsonian, but John is a social worker working with some of our most challenged students in this country. Too many of our young people are not being nurtured or mentored as they are not involved in groups like scouts and guides. We used to have community groups, sporting groups, cultural groups. What has happened? Where are they? And what bothers me is that we have increasing evidence that too many of our children, boys and girls, are in great need of children protective services to stamp out the specter of physical and sexual abuse of children in this country. We have to do more to protect our children. Too many of them are going missing when you read the paper. Too many of them are victims to trust in the wrong person in this country. Too many of them have been made to suffer. Too many children are having children. And while the physical scars may heal quickly, the psychological scars live with them for a lifetime. Let us be real. Our young people are tired of the political promises, jaded by the political gamesmanship. And we are in real danger of failing to inspire a generation of Barbadians in this country. Too many of them are falling through the cracks. Whether it is at the Polytechnic or UWE or BCC, many come out with qualifications but can't get no work. Many of our young people are home or on the blocks with nothing to do. And some have been home for years, never work in the life. Never work. And all that we do, we have to reset this country for the next generation. We have to. And we're prepared to do it. We know that we can create hundreds of new jobs in the ICT and services sector. We know that we will create an institute for nursing to be able to take more nurses because there's a global shortage in nursing. We know that we can literally expand the programs at the community college, the polytechnic, and the vocational board so that ordinary Bajans don't have to pay $2,100 to go and learn to be a mason. Can you believe that? And we will also facilitate funding for young entrepreneurs in this country. As it relates to vendors, forgive me this old one. You know, I met with the vendors of Barbados in 2006. And I made a promise to them that I was not able to keep and has to be one of the first promises that a Barbados Labour Party government shall keep. Because this is who we are. We need to stop before the third decade of the 21st century from criminalizing illegal vending on the cities of our country, on the streets of our country. I am appalled that my uncle was able to share with me an article of my grandfather fighting this same battle 70 years ago in this country. And we will get it right because we have people in Barbados selling illegal insurance policies without a license and not facing a day in court. But we want to carry ordinary good people selling legal goods before the court and give them a criminal conviction. I say to you tonight, there will be order and we will introduce a system of civil penalties, but we will not make Bajans criminals for selling to keep their families alive in this country. And to the poor and the vulnerable, the IDB said that poverty has gone up in this country. It wasn't a surprise, we knew it. But we told you last year, and I repeat it just for your memory today, every household in this country under a Barbados Labour Party government must have a minimum living income. Every household. It is the basis upon which people can survive. If there is no pension coming, if there is no welfare benefit, if there is no salary, what are you asking the poor people to do to eat food? What are you asking them to do to pay a light bill or to get water? We are better than that. And I say to you tonight that in addition to that, we must be prepared to rationalize the social safety net and ensure that key agencies have the right information systems and the right people to do what is necessary to lift people out of poverty in a real way. We are a progressive party. And you have heard me speak over and over and over about pit toilets. Not in the way that Frandell talks about them, Liz. No Barbadian. It offends me. It offends me that we can sit down in a cabinet room and we can talk about how to spend $4 billion and we can not see Trevor, not see Arthur, not see Marsha. I call their constituencies Joe. The people who tonight, if the rain fell like it fell in here last night after midnight, would have to brave the elements just to do the most basic of bodily functions. But we could build the grotto and Valerie for $55 million. when we can replace every single pit toilet with a waterborne facility in this country for 60 or 65 million. In one instance, one man gets the job to get profits to send overseas. But in the other instance, 80 to 100 contractors get work from St. Lucie to St. Philip in this country. No Barbadian parent wakes up and tells their children that we want you to get a pit toilet. So why and where do we get off? Where do we get off? Not recognizing that this is a moral imperative of our generation. And I say to you that the Barbados Labour Party government recognizes that and will do it as a priority while ensuring that ordinary people can get work in this country again to build those waterborne facilities from St. Lucie to St. Philip. And I haven't forgotten the pensioners. From the Clicquot debacle and the use and abuse of the national, bring the mic star, and the use and the abuse, thank you, and the use thank you. The Barbados Labour Party gives you this solemn commitment this evening. We are not going to use the National Insurance Scheme as government's piggy bank to enable the fiscal recklessness of a profligate government. You can go and pull down the actual review, the 15th one, for yourself now that they took so long, but Dwight had it for the last year. And we tell you that we are going to ensure that we strengthen regulations and oversight to make sure that people who have invested in private pensions in Barbados and insurance policies will be guaranteed the funds when they are due. You know, we recognize the hard work and the sacrifices that Bajans have made for their families and the country. And we cannot allow your future plans for old age to be plagued by the uncertainty that now exists around the National Insurance Fund. We also recognize, Sir Henry and Sir Richard, you are former chairman, that there is an issue in relation to the audited accounts, but we recognize that the Auditor General will get on top of it, because this is less of an issue that offends the eye as it may seem, but it is one that needs to be dealt with because it sends the wrong perception, especially after the government's raiding of its funds to the point where almost 80% of the funds, investments of the National Insurance Fund are in government-related activities. When we left government, the NIS held $1.4 billion in government paper. Today, it holds $3.8 billion because of this government. This has been the oxygen, along with the printing of money, that this government has used to stay afloat. Let me deal with the workers. Labour. This government, you will agree, is the most anti-labour government that this country has ever seen. It's not normal. The abuse that has been hurled at trade union leaders in Barbados by the Prime Minister and by other ministers who believe it is now their job to make mock sport at union leaders is outright disrespectful. It is unbelievable, the government's intransigence when it comes to labor. And I tell you tonight that whatever and whenever the government is advised to take a reasonable stance, they refuse, only to find egg on their face at the end of the day when they have to back down after the union takes action. A Barbados Labour Party government will work to restore stable industrial relations in this country. In this very park, 30,000 people walked off and came back a few months ago. We will respect our trades union. And I want to say to you that we will ensure that we return to good faith dealing rather than the current acrimony that exists. We will not make promises in a throne speech like this government to the labor movement and ignore it. We will work with them. And as it relates to public servants, understand that we have been agitating for public servant salary pay increase for the last 9 years. It is time to give the public servants of Barbados a wage increase. And at the very least, a cost of living allowance. This is a giveaway. And if the Dems want to give it to you and claim it as their idea, tell them do so now. We have no difficulty with it because it is too important for families to be stabilized in this country by it. And what does this government do instead? The NSRL on your back, but they still don't give you a wage increase. They take back the 10% and give to themselves, but no wage increase. And while I'm at it, let me thank the Salvation Army for its very generous letter, thanking the members of the Barbados Labour Party parliamentary team for the $27,000 donation that we made to them and to the Diabetes Foundation, because our parliamentary team refused to take the 10% pay increase and donated it to the Salvation Army and the Diabetes Foundation and will be donating every month to different charities. I'm proud to lead a team of men and women who could understand that you cannot have that kind of selfish and arbitrary behavior representing the public and the people of this country. I am proud, and I thank you in front of all of our party members for agreeing to put us in that position. And let me say quickly to the bus riders of this country, you know, the truth is that there's so much wrong. And that's why we have to go through all of this. This government has made you suffer. We have less than 80 buses, transport board buses, functioning in this country today. Less than 80. But we have 750 privately owned PSVs given to you under the cover of night. I don't know who. I don't know how. I don't know how much. I don't know where to. But I know this. We will not sell the transport board. We won't. But we will fix public transport in this country. And we will fix it not under cover of night, but in the broad daylight. There will be no allegations against any Barbados Labour Party member for the sale of bus licenses in this country. So I want to tell George Pilgrim, don't worry about the sale of the transport board. Worry about the fact that the transport board will have a forensic audit. A forensic audit. As well as the transport authority, a forensic audit. And we will learn how $20,000 can be paid to one mechanic, but yet buses that are working are getting less and less by the day. We will learn how you can still owe UKAL $20 million and not give them the parts to fix buses, but you can give a man from Trinidad all that he needs, even if the buses are not fixed. I know that the chairman of the transport board, the chairman who happened to be the chairman at the National Housing Corporation when Lashley was at housing, and who has refused, in spite of his legal knowledge about the validity of a summons, has refused at least 3 times to attend the Public Accounts Committee here in Kerry, in Jerome. Wilfred Dale will tell you. But for refusing to account for the national housing funds, this chairman has been carried like a wallet in a back pocket to the transport board. There will be a forensic audit of the transport board. And that is a most appropriate time for me to talk about the new governance of this country and the corruption that will be fought. Because the Barbados Labour Party has always given you the opportunity to be able to have a greater say in this country than the Democratic Labour Party. But even we understand now that there is time for a new governance framework. And I'm going to go through these measures very quickly. There's a written text for those who want the details of them. But I want to be able to share with you these things. Because we have in this country to stop the nonsense that produces a Cahill, to stop the nonsense that produces a Deltro in a National Botanical Gardens while the principals of Deltro, William, are spending time in prison, in jail, in Canada, and the people of Barbados have to run on roads if they want to jog rather than being able to run in a botanical gardens that has a wonderful sign up but only serves to dump sargassum weed and to be able to be the site of this botanical gardens. We were the ones who told you about Dennis Law and Michael Lashley and the cars at Transtech. We were the ones who told you about the whole Clico and Bico controversy. We were the ones who pointed out to you about the consolidation of wealth in the hands of one man who I call the billion-dollar man, mark my word. We believe that good government must be predictable, fair, and trustworthy. We will not agree on national policy and then cut a side deal with one group that puts everybody else at a disadvantage, like Sandals. We will not be giving you ad hoc concessions. We will restore to a level playing field a principle of government that you do not have separate rules for the same categories of persons. And I want to say to you, my friends, we will not implement retroactive legislation. It is bad, and it does not allow our people to plan. Because we understand that whatever gains you may think you are getting from the implementation, as Charles Tibbetts would tell you, of retroactive legislation, you are literally, literally ridding government of the people's confidence and trust when you do so. I say to you tonight, comrades, that we have to be true to our own selves. And we have to make sure that the legacy which we inherited from Grantley Adams, from Tom Adams, from Bree, and even from Owen Arthur, that we will not dishonor that legacy as we move to build a strong and honest and fair Barbados again. The infelicities and the cronyism and the backdoor dealings of this government has to go. And what I can say to you now is that we have already looked at what the new basic norms of good ministerial conduct must look like, and we are not prepared for them to be undermined by anybody at all. There will be a tough stance on corruption. The declaration of assets will be a requirement for all who want to serve in the Cabinet of Barbados. Not one, not any, from myself back down, must serve in trust for the people of this country without making a confidential declaration to an appropriate entity, and I will tell you what that entity will be in a second. In short, there will be zero tolerance of corruption in Barbados under the next Barbados Labour Party government. I asked you earlier, why has Frondell Stewart brought legislation to two houses of parliament, have the Governor General assent to it, and still will not proclaim it to make it law? Unless it is proclaimed as law, It can't be the law. Why is he allowing his ministers to operate without the framework of accountability that that legislation, however defective it was, would have given us? On three previous occasions, I openly said that the Barbados Labour Party will fight corruption and we will bring legislation to deal with it. Regrettably, I'm told I have to say it over and over and over, and I shall say it for the fourth time. But I go further tonight. I go further. Our brothers and sisters in the Caribbean, in the Commonwealth Caribbean, have already taken actions that should make us shame, because Barbados used to be a leader, not a follower. Only this week or last week, the Bahamas government took a model of legislation from the Turks and Caicos, the newly elected Bahamian government, and made it the law of the land with respect to the Integrity Commission. We will bring to Parliament, among our first pieces of legislation, integrity legislation and election campaign financing legislation. These will be separate bills, but I tell you tonight that we will establish an integrity commission, and that integrity commission must have constitutional protection, just as the Electoral and Boundaries Commission has constitutional protection in this country. But I went further, and I want to thank the lawyers in the Barbados Labour Party and the lawyers of independent conscience in this country, who for the last 4 weeks have spent their time drafting a new Integrity Commission bill for Barbados. This bill will be put on the website and the Facebook page next week. I wanted to put it tonight, but so careful are they that they have asked me for 3 or 4 more days. And when it goes up, we want the people of Barbados to write us on a clean, at an email called acleanbarbados@blp.org.bb and share your opinions. Because you will soon understand when I say that this will be among the first pieces of legislation of a Barbados Labour Party government. We mean it and we shall do it. We have the good fortune that a former member of this party and a former Chief Justice of Barbados, Sir David Simmons, chairs the Integrity Commission in the Turks and Caicos Islands, and has already agreed to offer his experience both to those who were drafting this legislation, for free by the way, for those who were drafting this legislation, and for those who will be required to help give life and body to the terms of the legislation. We look forward to the comments of the people of Barbados on this most critical piece of legislation and this new step into a new governance. We will give you a commercial court. And I'm tired telling you that, because you've been hearing that for 11 years and you ain't get it yet. But Dale, we will do it. And the criminal justice system is what really ought to concern us. We had a Judicial Council retreat in 2007 before we left government that left 102 recommendations to reform the criminal justice system in this country. Do you know that only 3 of those 102 recommendations have been implemented by this government in the decade that they have been in office? And those 3, a drug treatment court, the abolition of preliminary inquiries, and the bringing of plea bargaining legislation, are such that only 2 of them have even been implemented, even though talked about. Arthur Holder can tell you that. Well, tonight, I say to the people of this country, and there's a long list of things that we will do, but I want you to remember one thing. The time has come for us to legislate in this country that cases that are serious cases, whether it is murder, rape, burglary, robbery, kidnapping, that those cases must all start within 6 months of a person being charged in Barbados. And they will have to be case management and criminal cases. This is not breaking new ground. The OECS is already doing this. So when I tell you that we are now following rather than leading, believe you me, that is where we are today. In addition, we recognize that we need a 21st century police force. If there is one thing that is keeping Bajans up at night, is the fear of the crime that is breaking out in this society. And we are committed to making sure that you are safe in Barbados. The notion of automatic weapons terrifying people in communities is too much for a country of 166 square miles to bear. But I say to you, remember the early 1990s when we had a spike in crime in this country? Do you remember that? Well, we in the Labour Party came in and we reduced robberies and burglaries in this country to a third and a quarter of what it was, Ralph, from those early 1990s when you were a young criminal lawyer practicing in this country. And I say if we did it then, and if we worked with the police force and the defense force then, we shall and can do it again. And as we relate the constituency councils, forget about them, them gone. Barbados cannot afford a partisan act of ministers determining who should represent people at community levels. We will have democratically elected community councils that have nothing at all to do with politicians. And similarly, we will also make sure, and I want to thank Bishop Joe Atherley for this, that when we met with the Barbados Evangelical Association up to this week again, I have said, and it is in the covenant of hope, it's nothing new, that we should expand and renew our social partnership to include civil society and the churches of Barbados. But we recognize that for the seamless functioning of the social partnership, we may need a dedicated unit. And therefore, the dedicated unit will be a social justice division of the social partnership in which the churches and civil society will be appropriately represented to help us keep this country safe. And to the economy. To the economy. We get it right. And we've done it before. So much of the criticisms that this government has laid before us, Barbados is a society, not an economy. Little did you know that that was an idle boast to cover up the economic incompetence of the Democratic Labour Party. Well, they have now discovered that it is both a society and an economy. And they have now discovered that the very society they wanted to protect is now at risk. My friends, it takes cash to care. And anybody knows that freedom of choice requires you to have some ability to make that choice. And we have said to this country that we have to get the economy right. If not, those at the bottom will be the ones suffering the most in this country. And I'm going to share this bit with you, and I thank Ryan for it. At the end of Tom and Bree's tenure, 10 years in government, Barbadians, on average, were about $30,000 better off than they were when the Labour Party came to office in 1976. $30,000 better off in 86. At the end of 1994, Barbadians were on average $16,000 better. Not as much, but still better off than they were when the Dems came to office in 86. At the end of 2007, Barbadians, under the BLP and OIN, Bajans were $1,000 better off after 14 years on average of a BLP government in this country. $57,000 more. Ask me how you stand tonight under 10 years of the Democratic Labour Party. The average Barbadian is $20,000 worse off than when this government came to office in 2008. So when I tell you, I want you not to fear. We got this. We have this. On each occasion we have been faced with this challenge, we have come up to the task and we've done it. And once we have gone to the task of stabilizing the economy, stopping the bleeding, correcting the fiscal deficit, we will then get to the issue of growth and non-fiscal and fiscal measures to be able to grow this economy again. So growth for us is not an arbitrary or wishful thinking. We are prepared to usher in new approaches to our national economic development and to set us on a firm foundation for the next 50 years. When I spoke on productivity last week, I want us to move from where we are to where we need to be. Productivity is first and foremost about having a passion for your job. And if we are going to grow this economy, we need agents to have passion for their jobs. We may need to redefine what the jobs are to get absolute clarity. But I say to you that once we can do that, I know we can get there. Our most powerful resource is our people. And a government can command the confidence of ordinary people, workers and businesses to encourage them to invest in this country. This government, my friends, have lost the confidence of people in Barbados and the confidence of the business sector. The only way we can restore that confidence is to get things done in a way that is transparent, predictable, and fair. And I say to you that you need to get rid of this government because the only thing they invest in is not the country, but is politics and themselves. It may be hard, but I take no pleasure in doing it. One of the principal levers that we will have in an economy such as this is to make things easier, cheaper, and more predictable to work in Barbados. Regulation will play a vital part in our economy, a spur to investment. And we have been meeting with people for the last month across every sector in this country because we understand that we have to be ready from day one. We know that an economic policy of ours cannot be to tax our way to growth or to cut our way to growth. We know that there's definitely scope to reorganize our tax system in a sensible way, in a way that Chris Sinclair has not been doing. And we know that when the time comes, we will reduce exemptions and lower tax rates to where we can, when we can. But we will not be reckless with this economy or with the stability of this country. We know that for all intents and purposes, if we were to establish e-government tomorrow, we would have an opportunity in Barbados to be able to boost growth in this country and to create opportunities for people. Look at how many people would like to be able to renew their driver's license from this tent tonight. And we have the technology to do it. Why aren't we doing it? We have the ability to get into a sharing economy where we can maximize your assets in terms of Airbnb, maximize your assets in terms of being able to do the other things that allow you to barter because technology allows you to know what each other can trade. We were told, Kerry, last week, that school children in Barbados are trading in credit on cellular phones and that they are selling goods to each other and the currency is the credit on cell phones. Do you understand that this is primary school children in this country? And that the government of Barbados is holding back the creativity and the ingenuity of our people. Look, we are going to support small businesses in Barbados. We don't have a choice.
We do not have a choice. And we will facilitate the establishment of crowdfunding networks that plug in Barbados and Barbadian savers to opportunities that do not now exist. But above all else, we are going to reverse the national social responsibility levy in this country. And we will do it as one of the very first acts of our Labour Party Parliament. It is a bad tax. And nobody can ask anybody to plan for a 400% increase in 1 year. We believe that even before we deliver growth, the cutting out of corruption in this economy will start to save us tens of millions of dollars from what this government has been engaged in. This government has been using its powers to tax, to take money from ordinary people, to put it in the hands of a few, who get all the government contracts. It is a Robin Hood in reverse government, taking from the poor to give to the rich. I say to you, we will not put up with it. I ask you also to recall that I said that we think outside the box. We did it with the Deepwater Harbor. We did it with the Tom Adams Highway. And we can do it again. Whenever we look around, there are signs of disruption in our country. We hear about artificial intelligence and robots. And we know that we have the ability as a country for radical transformation, but we have people that are not taking us seriously. Barbados can become the first digital island and smart island in the world. But we have to set out to do it. We have a group of Barbadians that we met with on Wednesday, Thursday, who have the capacity, who have the ability, who want to see us create clusters, who want to see us have programs in creative, cultural, and technology clusters. From Holtown to Spikestown to Bridgetown to Oystons to the Glebe to Six Roads. These kids are way ahead of us. And we cannot hold them back. What we have to do is to make sure that we root them and allow them to be rooted in Barbadian values, but let them soar and engage with the rest of the world. That is the mission of the Barbados Labour Party. And as it comes to our public service, Barbados became who we are because we had one of the best public services in the region. Don't get tired. But we have lost ground. And we have to restore our civil service to the point where people want to become teachers, want to become policemen, want to become nurses in this country, want to become lifeguards, want to become administrators, where the best of Barbados believe that it is a badge of honor to give 5, 10, 7 years to your country. But it means that we got to change the terms and conditions of how we relate to them. And we need to give people the opportunity to become master teachers. Why should a teacher have to go into to administration to become the best teacher that they can be in this country? Why should a nurse have to become a sister focused on administration when her desire is to become the best clinical nurse that she could be, taking care of patients on the spot? Why should a policeman have to be promoted to have to do tons and tons of administration when that policeman is one of the best detectives or one of the best people to help work in this country, police in this country? A Barbados Labour Party government will create opportunities within the structure of government to appropriately compensate public servants in this country to be the best that they can be. And let me break it down for you very quickly. There are 22 secondary schools. If we put 10 master teachers at every secondary school and make sure that they can get a decent salary of $100,000 a year, the additional cost to government is less than $10 million a year. But what are we securing? The stability and the future of our children and the education of this country. You ask, Why don't men go into teaching? Many men tell you that they can't support their families. And we say to you tonight that we are going to create that career path for teachers and for policemen and for nurses in this country again, so that we can put the best of our citizens helping to keep this country safe and prosperous and fair yet again. It is a moment whose time has come, and we can no longer ignore that we are not attracting the best of Barbadians to make Barbados the best that it can be. And it applies to political service too, not just the civil service. And I want finally on innovation to speak about healthcare, because not only must we get the accident and emergency department right to stop treating people like if they're cattle waiting to hear and see somebody when they are most in pain and are most vulnerable, but we have to recognize that chronic non-communicable diseases in Barbados is a public emergency. It is costing us to spend too much money on healthcare because people are not taking responsibility for their own health. I say to you tonight that if it is that we can work with doctors to find an appropriate measurement to allow us to treat to the fact that it is costing us $14,000 a year to treat the average diabetic in the system who has full-blown diabetes. And if we can get that person through a diet and the proper exercise, Jerome tells me it doesn't work with everybody, but it can work with most. If we can do the appropriate tests and give them the appropriate Fitbit, I would prefer that a Labour Party government give them $2,000 a year if they meet the conditions of stabilizing their condition than paying $14,000 at a hospital to keep them well. When I say to you that we think outside of the box, believe you me, I don't have time tonight to talk about the CSME or the need for us to be able to use the resources of both people and money, or to take back leadership as we have abdicated under this Frondell Stewart-led administration. I don't have time to talk about how we innovated with the offshore drilling sector, with the maritime boundaries that we led and won 99% of what we wanted for Trinidad. I don't have time to talk about the renewable energy sector tonight. I will be addressing the Chamber of Commerce next month, and I will take the time then to go into detail on a lot of these matters that are fundamental to restoring this nation to stability and prosperity. And I want us to also remember that we in government don't know everything. And hence the reason why we are consulting now sector by sector by sector. Kerry is there telling you with me. We hearing it firsthand. And we want to encourage people, Clyde, to be able to continue to give us their views, because we do not believe that the people in the Barbados Labour Party are the only people who have knowledge in this country. And finally, we get things done. You know it, and we know it. I've said enough tonight to show you how we get it done. But I want you to do one thing before I start to close. You remember when garbage used to get picked up regularly in this country? You remember when there would always be water when you turn on the tap? You remember a time when the cost of living was manageable, that you could make ends meet? You remember a time when roads were not an obstacle course? Do you remember going to the supermarket and not being filled with a sense of dread? Do you remember going to the hospital and not being filled with a sense of fear? Do you remember that we could go to sleep knowing that if our child wanted to do medicine or law or engineering or management, that the government would make sure that they had the chance to do it? Do you remember a time when the medicine, the drugs, the pharmaceuticals, Adrian, was affordable? Isn't it shocking how far we have fallen in so short a time? People expect us to deliver, and we will. We will. I therefore want you to walk with me. Walk with me on this image. Because tonight before this crowd at Queen's Park, I solemnly commit to you that should it be the will of the people of Barbados to elect us as the next government of this country, this is what the order paper on the first working day of a Barbados Labour Party government will look like in the parliament of this country. We shall have the first reading of a bill to decriminalize illegal vending in this country, as I promised. We shall have the first reading of the Integrity Commission Bill of Barbados on the first working day of a parliament of a Barbados Labour Party government. We shall have legislation repealing the National Social Responsibility Levy and the Solid Waste Tax on the first working day of Parliament in Barbados for Barbados Labour Party government. Dale, we shall also be repealing the legislation requiring tax clearance certificates for property transactions in this country. An iniquitous and vicious act that affects more poor people with savings who have property than it affects large people who have cash in this country. And while we're at it, we shall review the policy that requires a tax clearance certificate for foreign exchange wires under a certain threshold in this country. It is wrong and only enriching Western Union in Barbados. But that's not all the order paper will have. Whosoever shall have the pleasure to be the Minister of Education shall also be rising to give their first ministerial statement. And in that ministerial statement on that first working day of Parliament, they shall commit the government of Barbados to paying fees for the students of Barbados at the University of the West Indies from academic year 2018 to 2019. I make this solemn commitment to you, the people of Barbados, standing here at Queen's Park tonight in the capital city of our town, that should it be the will of the people, you do not have to ask what your government will be doing on the first working day of its parliament. But I go further. I stand here tonight to commit to you that the Barbados Labour Party economic team, which has been working for the last 12 months on the conditions which we face, will be in a position for us to present to the country its first economic stabilization and growth plan for the people of Barbados within 6 weeks of being elected as the government of this country. I want to thank the people who have been working assiduously to put us in this place. Clyde Maskell, thank you. Ryan Strawn and Marsha Cattle, thank you. Avinash Prasad, thank you. And there are others, trust me, who at the right time we will let you know. The problem is that there are those who will say, well, how do you know the true state of arrears? And how do you know the true state of the contingency funds? Well, that is true. But what we have determined is that we cannot stay silent. And while we expect that the arrears are in the vicinity of $1.5 billion and the contingency liabilities are in excess of $2 billion, we have to stop the bleeding at all costs in this country. You cannot restructure this economy unless we stop the bleeding. You cannot operate on the patient unless we stop the bleeding. So my friends, I have been at pains this evening to talk to you in this way, to tell you what sets us apart from this Democratic Labour Party government. I may have taken a little long, but you don't get a chance to make your case to the people of the country twice. And we are making this case to the people of this party first, conscious that whenever Frondell Stewart brings that bell, we will then make it to the people of Barbados. We are conscious that this country is waiting on a rescue mission. And I am proud that the party that I lead, proud to lead this party, that has known what it is on every occasion, without exception, when asked to help Barbadians and to lead Barbados out of the quagmire, the Barbados Labour Party stands tall and says, here are we. We are ready and focused for the job. In all that we do, we will put the people first. We will treat people right because, listen to me, there will be no first class, nor second class, nor third class citizens under the Barbados Labour Party. There will be none in my office. There will be none in my government, and there will be none in this country. And I want people to understand that how we treat one another is the most precious gift that allows us to distinguish ourselves from other animals on this earth. The ability to care. People will forgive incompetence. People will may even forget corruption, regrettably. But people will never forget how you make them feel or whether you care enough for them. We will make you understand that you matter to us, and that ownership matters, and that Barbadians must not become tenants in their own country because of a government not giving them opportunities to participate in the rebuilding or the economic transformation of this nation. It is wrong, and it will not happen under a Barbados Labour Party government. So, comrades, ready yourself. Ready yourself. I say to the rank and file in particular, and these lights, not a good thing, but I've come out front to speak to the rank and file because you are the ones that make this party a mass-based party. Without you, we are nothing. I want to repeat it. Without you, this Barbados Labour Party is nothing. And I stand here tonight to solemnly pledge to you that we will not dishonor the time, the sacrifice, the love, or the commitment that you put in the candidates of this party as we seek to restore and transform Barbados. Because it matters to us that you live every day and every night to make this party a great party. And to the candidates of the Labour Party, ours will be a special journey. We may not always agree on everything, but we will always agree to put country first and to put the ideals of this party, which are honorable in building this country, above personal situations and personal circumstances. We don't have a lot. I can't promise you manna from heaven. I can't promise you perfection. But I will promise you that this team here will come to work every day, to work hard and to do the best that they can, because this country has been good to us, and it is now time for us to be good to this country. So I ask you tonight, Peter Phillips, where are you? Come forward, my son. We are going to start in the north. And I know that whenever I ask Peter, are you on board with us? Peter, are you on board with this journey? You heard him tonight. And I'm asking him for a special reason. Because when it starts in the north, by the time we get to St. Peter, Colin Jordan, stand up and come. By the time we get to St. Andrew, George Payne, it can't go nowhere without you. Come right up, George. By the time we go across to St. Joseph, Dale Marshall, come right up. Cynthia Ford, you are in the center of the island and the salt of the earth. Come, my dear. Kerry Simmons, Edmund Hinkson, and Sandra Husbands, come. This is the Northern team of the Barbados Labour Party. But we can't do it alone in the North. We can't do it alone in the North. I want Charles Griffith in the East to step up, because he is going to do some funny things. Some funny, 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 funny things in St. John. And I want Sonia Brown in St. Philip North. Because, believe you me, she is going to be the googly of this campaign. And I want John King in St. Philip West and in Darwin in St. Philip South. Come right on up.
I got it.
And Glenn Clark. And Glenn, we have, and thank you for coming. We know that your brother passed yesterday, and the sympathies of the entire Barbados Labour Party family are with you. Glenn, and the young, young, dynamic one, batting from in front all the time, Dwight Sutherland. But when you leave there, you have to go into Edie Village and pick out Ryan Strawn. Ryan, where are you? Are you on board? And Wilfred Abrams, are you on board? And Ralph Thorne, are you on board? And when we finish with that, Adrian Medic Ford to the rescue. And who comes back to anchor Christ Church? The sheriff in town, do good and good shall attend you. You know, the others gonna quarrel and say that I left the best for the last. That's not true. I just left the most to call for the last. Because when Ronald Toppin starts in St. Michael North, you know that everything anchor off. Toppin is on board all the time. Because there will be no stopping Toppin. And when the bishop comes to save the people of St. Michael West from those who do not know right from wrong and who cannot give back to the people the monies that are due and owing to their clients, then we know that we have been anchored well in morality and integrity. But those same people have now to contend with the fact that there is a man who is like a King Ras. King Ras. He is perhaps the most popular person in St. Michael who has not served as a candidate, as a member of parliament yet. I speak of no other than Arthur Holder. But you leave me to ask, my brother Trevor Prescott, are you on board? And you leave me to ask Marsha whether she is going to share the care, commitment, and courage to take out the man who is the perfect parody of a politician. Here, and Kurt, I wish I could rhyme and rap like you. Come on board, star. You can rap for me later. And Santia Bradshaw, let it be known that you are fully on board. And Neil Rowe. There's a story called David and Goliath. I want you to meet the David of the Barbados Labour Party. Neil Rowe, are you on board? And on my right, If you come down Spooner's Hill, he's on my right. If you go across Long Gap, he's on my left. Ian Gooden Edgell. Not last, not least, but our host. Our host. Our host. Where are you, sir? Where are you? The Colonel, the Member of Parliament for the City of Bridgetown, are you on board? Are you boarded? Ladies and gentlemen, it is not ours to decide if we will be the next government, but it is ours to offer to be the next government. It is for you and the people of Barbados to now decide, are you on board? All aboard, ladies and gentlemen, to the task, good night, and God bless.